Of course, you can trade anecdote for anecdote. You know, Morgan Stanley has moved 14 people to Frankfurt or wherever. On the other hand, you know, ING has moved its headquarters to London. Deutsche Bank has moved its headquarters to London. Wells Fargo spent $300 million on a new headquarters in London. You know, big new fund today from the Netherlands, literally, it was announced yesterday, has made the same decision. So we can, you know, we can argue that back and forth. But the way I'd have thought you measure what's been happening is you look at how many people are employed in financial services in London. And there are various employment agencies that do this, and there are two in particular. One of them says that hiring from last July to this July was up 14%. The other one said it was up 17%. So on the basis of what we can currently see, there has been a net movement of people to London. Now, of course, it is possible that we could screw this up. There are ways in which it could go wrong. But I'll be honest, I don't think those ways are really to do with what deal we get with the EU. I think the real threat to London is the idea of a Chavist government here, which is overtly and proudly hostile to the whole notion of the free movement of capital. And, I mean, this is... So I'm now going to, I'm afraid, end on a slightly somber note, having been doing my best to be, you know, rationally optimistic all morning. But there is, I think I owe it to be honest, there is something out there which is a much, much more serious threat to our national prosperity than any of these EU things, and that is what's happened to public opinion here. You know, the last election, 2 in 5 people voted for a candidate who regrets the outcome of the Cold War. Quite seriously, you know. I mean, it was an almost incredible situation. Now, those of you who were lucky enough to grow up in this country, in a liberal, prosperous, and secure democracy, I don't think can begin to imagine what it's like to have that sort of government. We've never had one here. When I was at school, the implicit message in my politics O-level was extremism is something that they do in hot countries where the leaders wear sunglasses and headgear, right? It's not the kind of thing we do here. We've never had a fascist MP. We've only ever had 2 communists, right? That wasn't my experience in childhood. I grew up in South America. When I was 5 years old, a mob invaded our family farm. There were confiscations without compensation all over the country. There was constant power cuts, eventually something close to a civil war. Peru, where I grew up, was thrown by a bad Corbyn-style government into a state of squalor that it took 30 years to recover from. And you know where they all fled to? Everyone who could get out? You know the place they all emigrated to for a new life and for a better chance? Venezuela. Because Venezuela then was the first world country in South America. It was the place that was geographically in South America, but that economically was more like Spain or Italy. Look at how quickly that country has been destroyed by someone that Jeremy Corbyn regards as a hero and a great leader. I was just astonished at the last election that it even needed to happen, but he was asked on a TV program, is there any war where you'd have backed us? Because of course, there's someone who was pro-IRA, who was pro-Soviet Union, Hamas and Hezbollah, somebody who didn't even back us in the Falklands War, right? Extraordinary thing that someone aspiring to be Prime Minister of the United Kingdom has to be asked that question. Is there any war where you'd have been on our side? And he had to really think about it. And in the end, he said, the Second World War. And I was thinking, yeah, maybe after Operation Barbarossa. Not until then, you know. So I just don't think people have, you know, I was at the Tory party conference last week, and I just don't think people have begun